Start recording.
The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello, this is James Barnum from eatperform.com. I'm coming at you from beautiful Spring Hill, Florida, although it's 40 degrees here. I'm filling in for
Indeed.
Paul. He's got important business to attend to tonight, so you get me. I am joined by the lovely and talented April Blackford, as well as the author of Metflex for Fat Loss, Mike T. Nelson. Hi, April.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Mike.
Hey,
Hi. We're going to attempt to answer your nutrition and performance questions tonight. I'd like to thank you for joining. And without further ado, let's get started. If you can ask questions, I would greatly appreciate it, and we can start answering some of them.
so how was your guys' New Year's?
Mine was pretty uneventful. I went to a bonfire and drank some Yuengling, if that's how you pronounce it.
What the heck is that?
I think it's
Yuengling.
Yingling.
I'd like to think it's pronounced Yuengling. I'm not sure though. I don't really drink beer very often. But yep, I went to a bonfire and got nice and toasty. Came home and went to bed. As I get older, I just don't do a lot during holidays like that. But Christmas was great. I went over to my little brother's girlfriend's house and met her parents and some of her relatives, and her uncle just had a baby, so it's always nice to welcome babies into the world. How about you, Mike?
Not too exciting. We just went over to some friends of ours who actually built a new house and have a 4-month-old now. So we stayed overnight at their place, hung out, ate Chipotle, had a few beverages, and barely stayed awake till 2 minutes after midnight and went to sleep. That
All right. How about you,
was
April?
good, though. Just basically hung out at the house, ate some filet mignon and some oysters, and stayed up till about 5 minutes after midnight and then went to sleep. So nothing special.
All right.
Yeah, the surf and turf sort of.
That's right.
Get
I
your
can't.
protein.
Yeah, exactly. Had a big leg day the next day, so.
Oh, there you go. Perfect.
All right, I've got our first question. Let's do
Okay.
this thing. I want to make sure I do this right. See who asked this question. I've got it in a tiny little window where I can't really see. Do do do. All right, this is from Michael Silverman. Michael, thank you for joining us. Michael asks, when do we count, when we do our counts for protein, fat, and carbs, are we counting all carbs or starchy type carbs only? For example, almonds have carbs. Do they count towards our total? I'm going to defer to April first because apparently everyone wants to hear her talk a little bit more.
I actually count everything, but it's only to keep me honest. There's a lot of folks who do not count carbs and fibrous veggies, but I do only because I came from a vegetarian background prior to reintroducing meat, and it's easy for me to eat a couple pounds of vegetables a day. So by me counting the carbs in my vegetables, it keeps me honest, and I don't overeat vegetables like I used to. So I kind of keep my servings, the minimal amount and get my macronutrients in every meal rather than just overloading on vegetables. So
What do you think, Mike?
I do the minimalist approach. I count the minimalist stuff possible. So for most things, for like protein, I know you asked about carbohydrates, but for protein stuff, I tell people just count complete proteins to start with, right? So any dead animal, dairy, that type of thing. Yeah, there's some protein in a few beans, and there's protein in other things, but I usually just generally don't count them initially. If you need to drill down and become more specific, then you can. I kind of do the same thing with carbohydrates. So usually I count pre and post, and then starchy-ish carbohydrates first. Yeah, if they're still having some issues, they still need a little more tweaking, then I maybe will make it a little bit more specific then. I tend to take the more minimalist approach initially.
Under what circumstances would you get a little bit more precise with that?
I would if they're not seeing the result that they would expect. So my end goal is sort of the having them track as minimal amount of stuff as possible, but still getting a result. So they said, okay, I'm tracking 30 carbohydrates, here's where I'm at, and I'm still not getting to my body composition goals. You know, maybe for 3 days to a couple weeks, I may have them track everything very specifically, just to get an idea of where they're at and possibly adjust from there. So I usually go based on the results.
All right. Well, I'm basically in the same boat as you, Mike. I get up every morning and have some mixed vegetables with some ground beef, and I don't count those at all, but I do tend to eat a lot of them. It's just for my training volume, I really don't feel as though I'm ever going to go over, especially if that's on a rest day, and my rest days typically involve trying to throw myself up into a handstand or doing pull-ups or going on a walk, jumping rope. So I'm not usually worried about it, but I'm actually cutting weight at this point because I got really big and now I want abs again. So I'm trying to do it without screwing up my my strength and everything. So I'm not counting yet, but as I approach, I'm trying to drop down to sub 10% body fat if I still want to do that. As I approach the 11% or so, I think I'm going to start counting my vegetables again. I hope that answers your question. How do I move on to another one? I'm new to this whole thing. I've never done one before. Thankfully, I've got Mike and April with me. I think I'm ready for another question. If you have any questions at all, whether they're specific or vague, feel free to ask.
I agree with what Mike was saying in regards to in the beginning having someone track usually for 3 weeks or so, because we have a lot of in the forum we have a lot of that people that come from paleo and they intuitively eat and so forth, and a lot of times they don't really know how low calories they're eating prior to coming in to eat to perform until they actually track for a couple of weeks, and then they're like, holy cow, I was only eating like 1,300 calories a day, how is that possible type thing. I also usually like to recommend to track for a short period of time just so you can see if you came from a lower calorie standpoint, just so you can see what that amount of food looks like. So if you're supposed to eat 200 grams of carbs a day based off your activity level, you need to know what 200 grams of starchy carbs looks like. Don't just assume, half a cup of rice, and throw in a little bit of oatmeal or whatever, that type of thing is gonna be sufficient enough. So sometimes it takes, actually tracking to see what you actually need and then get the feel and get adjusted to the quantity of the food as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I think if you're new or you're beginning a new exercise program, you're beginning a new diet, and I say that in quotes because it should really be a nutrition approach that you can follow for the rest of your life. It's extremely useful to check in and track your food. Maybe do that every several months. Just take a couple days. Take a training day. Take a rest day and see where you're at. I know from personal experience that I thought I was eating a lot more than I was, and I was eating a lot for a long period of time, but my body caught up to me and my appetite caught up to me, and I was eating probably 2,500 calories when I thought I was eating close to 3,000. So I think it's useful to check in once in a while, although you don't want to make that an everyday approach, because for some people it can kind of drive you crazy. And it's absolutely not necessary unless you feel better about micromanaging things and knowing exactly what you're eating. I don't in particular.
Yeah, Paul and I discussed this. He actually usually mentions it on almost every webinar, because him and I are opposite, because he eats intuitively and I track, but I only have to track because if I don't, I will undereat. Every single time, I have to track to make sure that I'm eating enough because I'm basically consistently trying to build muscle. Now, if I was cutting, I don't track anything. I don't count calories whenever I'm trying to cut body fat.
You're the inverse of what almost everyone normally does.
Yeah. All right, I got some more questions. Thank you, guys. What would the difference be if I ate oatmeal or took a carb powder pre-workout? That's from Neil Weglertz. I'm going to have Mike go first this time.
From a macronutrition standpoint, probably not a huge difference if we assume that the calories are the same. The big thing usually with pre-training is a lot of times just what you can digest and how you feel. I mean, I know guys that will eat bacon and eggs and potatoes and go bench press in a half hour. It doesn't bother and they can do whatever. Other people eating anything within an hour or 2 hours before, they just don't feel very good at all, no matter what it is. It's a pretty wide spectrum. Mm-hmm. So usually I go for, you know, what is about the amount where you're at? How well do you tolerate it? So how is your training performance? And if that goes well, if I had a preference, I do actually like a little bit higher glycemic carbohydrates, usually before training. Again, that depends on how the person reacts, assuming they have a good reaction to it. Rationale for that is that I'm actually trying to increase insulin a little bit more. So if you increase insulin, that pushes your body to use more carbohydrates. And there isn't a lot of direct evidence for it so far, but it makes sense that if you look at what you're trying to do with a strength training session, you really want the body to use as much carbohydrates as possible. You want to get the highest performance and power output and all that kind of stuff that you can. And in theory, that should correspond with a higher level of insulin. Higher insulin pushes your body to use more carbohydrates. The opposite is also true, right? So if you have, some people actually program in like a, what I call an aerobic or an aerobic-based type session. It's basically just a recovery day. Go out, do some very low intensity work, don't breathe real hard. For people that are really hard charging people, I stick a heart rate monitor on them, you know, don't go above about 120, 130. And ideally those sessions I have them be fasted. Mm-hmm. Why? Because I'm trying to increase the use of fats as a primary fuel source during that session. So the takeaway, what I usually look at is, you know, what is the amount, how well do you tolerate it, how good is your performance. All those are still good, and I had a choice and a heavier volume-based weight training session. I would go with a little bit higher glycemic-type carbohydrate, assuming it would be okay. But, you know, oatmeal is a good choice, too. It's a bad choice at all.
In my opinion, I mean, I've experimented with whole foods. I've pureed up everything from sweet and white potatoes to plantains. I do bananas right now. All kinds of carbohydrate powders, Vitargo, and the only thing that I've noticed a difference with really is that in the middle of my workouts, if I'm using something that's a whole food, I don't understand why, obviously, because I think it goes pretty deep, but I just don't perform as well. If I do an hour-long, like a fast-paced powerlifting session where I'm taking maybe like 2-minute breaks, today I squatted, I did two sets of, it was a repetition day, I'm following Brandon Lilly's cube method, so I got really tired near the middle of it, and I just had a protein shake with 50 grams of protein, and a single banana, which was around 25 grams of carbohydrates. You know, that's a 2-to-1 ratio, but flipped the other way around. So I think, I think I prefer a carbohydrate powder. Not necessarily maltodextrin or anything, but Vitargo makes a huge, huge, huge difference in how I feel. Mike, why would you suggest that someone do fasted training? Does that really make much of a – I'm not weight training, but low-intensity cardio, walking or something like that. Does that make much of a difference in terms of overall fat loss over the course of, say, 10 weeks?
Probably not, to be perfectly honest. If you look at a lot of the studies, yes, it's true that if you do a fasted session, you will use more fats during that session. So we used to take people in the lab, we hook them up to a metabolic cart, they breathe in a little tube, and this little number on the screen would tell you the percentage of fats versus carbohydrates they're using. So respiratory exchange ratio or respiratory quotient. Mm-hmm. And if you have someone who's fasted, you will see that that number is normally lower. The lower number indicates more use of fat as a fuel during that particular session? Does that really add up to be a massive difference overall? Yeah, it's pretty debatable. It's still going to be dependent upon the amount of work that you're doing. But the other reason that I like to do it is I want, if you look at it, there's some interesting data, and this is in the MedFlex book too, about mitochondrial biogenesis, increasing basically the aerobic pathway, and it appears that high levels of insulin blunt that effect. So I'm trying to keep insulin relatively low. I'm trying to increase mitochondria possibly, and increasing the body is basically just its use of fuel. And the reason for that is obviously, hopefully over time, you can have your body at a lower intensity, use a larger percentage of fat. Mm-hmm. And then also what I found too is that when you're doing a strength training session, so if you're in the gym, right, and you're doing squats, so during the exercise of doing squats, you're primarily using carbohydrates. But as soon as you rack the weight and start resting and just light movement, your body switches primarily to using fat at that point. Where people say, you know, EPOC, right, from the oxygen debt. Mm-hmm. And that process is actually an aerobic process, right, because usually you're breathing pretty hard, that type of thing. At that point, you actually want to use as much fat as possible. So if you can take someone, all things being equal, and they have a higher aerobic capacity, you can actually have them do a higher density of work in the gym because they're set to set recovery, all things being equal, is normally a little bit better. So that's the other reason I have people do that also.
That is extremely interesting. April.
It's a little bit out there, but, you know.
Yeah, it's a little bit, but I mean, I've noticed in the past when I was leaner that, doing fasted cardio, especially walking or riding a bike at a very moderate pace, I got really lean and I was still counting calories and everything. I was still eating about a 10 or 15% deficit, but it just seemed to go a little bit quicker. And I'm not sure if it was the added activity or it was because I was doing it fasted. Before I move on to the next question, just real quick, April, what are your thoughts on doing fasted cardio?
Fasted cardio, I agree with what Michael was saying. Also in regards to what you were just saying, during my last cut, I would do fasted cardio. It was just lifts for 40, 45 minutes on my off days, but I would do it first thing in the morning before I ate anything, and it seemed to work well for me. Me personally, I wouldn't do any other than just the low-intensity cardio or maybe like a short hit session. I wouldn't do any other training fasted. I don't agree with it. Of course, my workouts typically last longer. You know, they're a longer duration. In regards to the question Neil had, my opinion on the choice between the carb powder and the oatmeal would be based on how long his training session lasts. I typically do better with whole foods. My workouts include mobility, you know, mobility in the beginning, rolling, everything usually lasts anywhere an hour and a half to 2 hours. Whole foods, and I usually do Botargo for intro workouts because Botargo kind of keeps me going. But me, because my workouts last longer, I think the carb powder in the beginning would probably have me crashing during the middle of the workout. And I think that the oatmeal will sustain. So I think it will be based off of how long his workouts are and the duration, exactly what he's doing. If he's doing something like, you know, CrossFit, a Metcon, you know, a quicker with a strength session, I think the Targo would probably be very ideal for him. But, you know, if he's doing a couple hours of crazy training, you know, I think he may do better with some whole foods.
All right, I can agree with that. Let's move on. Bob asked, how should my intake change while working through injuries and not being able to work out? That's a very serious question right there. I have not personally dealt with any clients that have been injured, but what I know theoretically is that your intake should drop just a little bit. You don't have quite the same energy requirements, but if you were to look at it like, all right, I'm inactive, I don't want to put on a lot of body fat, then you're going to miss the opportunity to heal. Mike, I think you have a very good insight into that, probably.
You're saying I've been injured a lot? This is actually true.
No, I mean, you know what I mean. Go for it, man.
No, actually, I have been injured a lot in the past. I have, unfortunately, firsthand, and I've, for better or worse, worked with a lot of clients who have injuries and that type of thing. I look at it to see what their main goals are and what they're doing as an athlete. So two extremes, right? So the one extreme would be someone who's more of an advanced athlete, very in touch with their body. They're pretty good at, you know, gaining weight and losing weight. They've got that kind of dialed in and figured out. Their biggest thing is they can't have much time off. So with those people, I actually will have them slightly increase their calories, because depending on the injury, a lot of times injuries are much more calorically intensive than people realize. Again, it all depends on, you know, what kind of trauma they had, whatever it is. Knowing that once they get done and heal, that they can get their body composition back in order. So if they overshot, let's say, and gained 3 or 4 pounds of fat, but they got, you know, well better, to them that's usually a pretty acceptable thing. You know, they can lose that in a couple weeks or whatever and they're okay. But someone who's more of a, I don't like the word average, but, you know, kind of, you know, more average athlete.
Maybe not a competitive athlete.
Yeah, not quite as competitive, where, you know, if it takes them a couple, you know, 2 or 3 weeks to heal, it's not going to be the end of the world. You know, there's not a lot of money on the line, that type of thing. It's kind of hit or miss. I usually tell them just to keep an eye on their body composition and then also have another marker of what they can do for performance related to pain. So in a perfect world, you'd want to see their body composition staying about even. I don't like people to try to cut fat when they're injured. Usually that's the first thing that they want to do, because the rationale is, oh, I'm injured, I can't do anything, so I'm going to dramatically drop my calories. Usually I never see that work real well. It just delays and screws everything up. So in a perfect world, they would say right about even is what I would say. And that their progression with the injury would get a little bit better and better over time. And last thing on that, too, is I usually challenge them if their physician okays it to do something anyway. So, for example, oh man, 8 years ago, I busted up my ankle snowboarding, had a walking cast, crutches, all this kind of stuff. So I was taking a cab to go to the gym, and obviously I couldn't do any lower body stuff, but I could, you know, use my crutches to get over and do hammer strength pull downs and, you know, some presses, some curls, whatever. Is it ideal? No. Is it the best? No. But I was able to get in there and I was able to do something. A lot of people tend to be all or nothing. So if you can just get into the gym, you know, don't do anything that's painful, don't re-injure yourself, don't be stupid, but just do another body part that, you know, maybe you haven't, you know, specialized on for a while. Steve Cotter does a lot of kettlebell stuff. I think he injured his wrist or shoulder, I can't remember once, pretty bad. And so he started doing pistols for like 3 or 4 months. And he liked it so much he kept training pistols after that. And now he can do basically a one-legged squat from the floor up to like a table. It's freaky. But he took that time to do something that was completely different and was still able to make very good progress on it.
All right. Well, I have chronic injuries. Everything in my body hurts at this point because I've been training for 2 years straight, essentially without much of a deload, without any.
There you go.
So, the way that I look at it is when I feel like something's about to snap, when something, let's say I did a meet in October. And during my bench press, I fell out of the groove and it wasn't with anything heavy. Don't misunderstand me, but I tweaked my back, and this was an injury that had actually occurred while I was squatting 3 or 4 weeks beforehand with a relatively lightweight, and I just shifted the bar on my back, and I hurt myself. And from that point on, the way that I approached it, the way that I thought about it was, all right, I want to perform well. I need energy. I need to recover. So what can I do to make that better? So not only did I increase my calories, and that's when I actually started counting again. I said earlier that I had kind of let that slide off and I was eating a lot less than I thought I was. I increased my calories to about 3,200, 3,400 calories on training days and went and ate about 3,000 on my rest days and gave myself plenty of food to recover from that injury. And it felt great up until the point where I fell out of the groove at the meet and hurt myself. My knees are kind of screwed up from squatting with really bad form. My shoulders pop out of the sockets. I was actually born with clubbed feet. I was supposed to be Forrest Gump. I'm not supposed to be walking or squatting or doing anything. But I find that if I under-eat too much, and if I'm trying to cut weight, that's kind of an issue. If I under-eat too much, it really does mess with things. So I haven't dealt with being completely out of the gym, because I'm the kind of guy that's just like go and train even though I'm sick. Just like you, Mike, if I broke my leg, I'd get to the gym and I would do I'd do curls if that was all I could do.
Yeah.
But
there's a guy at my gym with a broken ankle right now, and he has this little motorized scooter that he wheels on with his foot on, and then just goes through and does upper body stuff like the whole time, you know. Yep. His motorized scooter, just kind of funny. Dedication, you know. I'd probably do the same thing, I'm sure.
Yeah, and I always ask people, it's like, it's the same thing in nutrition. I'm very big on, you know, what can you do? So focus on the things you can control, the things you can do, you know, eat more, right? So things we all talk about, eat more protein, eat more of these veggies, that type of thing. So it's no different when you're injured, right? It's obviously you got to let it heal, do whatever you can to, you know, get it to recover. But then, you know, sit down with my clients, make out a list. Okay, you know, so at one point I ripped on my right shoulder, so I couldn't do anything like this. I couldn't really do much of any movement because any jarring of it hurt like hell. So, yeah, a lot of left arm, you know, bicep curls, one arm, you know, pressing, weird stuff. But, you know, was able to do some stuff, you know, so usually something you can do to get a little bit better. I'm usually not a fan of people saying, well, I'm going to become so asymmetric, man, I'm just not going to train. Like, no, in a couple months, I don't think you can become that far out of whack. Most people at the end will recover much better anyway by being more active, so.
I'm not sure how much truth there is in it, but I've read that if you train one arm, the other arm will actually respond with strength adaptations. Maybe it won't grow. So is there truth to that?
Yep, it's called the neuro cross education effect. So it's nervous system adaptation, and it's probably because humans are bipedals, so they walk, and they're in essence symmetrical, right? There's some stuff that's asymmetrical, lungs are different size, hearts on one size, whatever. But we have, you know, two hands, two arms, two legs, right? So in essence, we're pretty symmetrical. And it would make sense from a survival standpoint that your body tries to keep some semblance of symmetry. So that's probably where that's from. There's another interesting one too, which is not well known, but it's actually an opposite effect. So if you injure, let's say, your right shoulder, I would actually have people look at doing stuff with their left hip, right? Because if you look at how humans walk, they do the opposite motion with the opposite side of the body, right? Arm swing, arm, you know, left leg swing, that type of thing. So I'll have them do specific movements with the opposite limb that are the opposite of what they injure. So, for example, if they can't bring their arm forward, I would have them bring their left leg back and do exercises there. Seems to help recovery from injury a little bit better, and then obviously working the opposite side seems to help you.
All right, well, I think that's extremely interesting, but I'd say it's a little bit, I'd say it's time to move on to another question if we can.
Yeah.
All right, and please excuse me if anything's popping up on the screen. As I said, I'm new to using this software, so trying to make it work. All right, here we go. We have a question from Bob. Says, thank you. Bob, you are extremely welcome. Thank you. We have a question from Michelle Silverman. I hope I got it right that time. Not Michael. I haven't started ETP yet. I've read the material but haven't officially started. I'm coming from a 1,200-calorie type diet with little to no carbs. I'm doing WODs 3 to 4 times a week at 5:15 a.m. at my CrossFit box. And after doing this for a few months, I'm starting to feel run down, but I'm totally freaked out about adding carbs, which is an extremely common thing. Using the calculator, how do I take the info given for eating on my workout days and convert that to a rest day? How much should I drop my calories and breakdowns for those days? This is a totally new type of eating plan, and I'm a little freaked out about eating more to lose fat and weight. And it's Michelle, like the Beatles song, not Michael. I hope I got that right, or I'll feel silly. So I'll kick this one off. I usually recommend, and this is standard, that on your rest days, you go, well, the standard recommendation would be that maybe you drop your calories, and this should come from carbohydrates, about 10%. Just give it a little go. And from there, depending upon how much fat you have to lose, depending upon your training status, your training age, depending upon 100,000 different factors, you can actually get pretty aggressive with your carbohydrate reduction, or whatever you feel comfortable with, really. And I'll overload this with some anecdote. For me personally, on days where I'm just doing jump rope and gymnastics and stuff, my rest days, which are active recovery days, or however you want to look at it, I typically, instead of looking at my calories and stuff, I typically just modify my nutrition choices. So instead of a post-workout meal that consists of chicken and mashed potatoes, which is really common for me because that's low fat, high carb, should absorb fast. You got plenty of protein in there. I'll go for some chicken and then maybe cut the potatoes in half or something. So I won't cut carbs out. I'll keep my workout shake in there because I feel like if I don't, I end up with no energy at the end of the workout and I'm on my last set of an assistance movement and I'm just like done. And if I CrossFit, see that's the thing. I'm not entirely sure what to recommend if you're working out. Let's go back. I need to look at the specifics of this. 3 or 4 times a week. Yeah, April.
I would recommend that she start out with moderately active. In regard to her rest days, I think it's dependent upon what her goals are, if it's to drop body fat or if she's trying to gain muscle or whatever. I think her rest days are going to be dependent upon her goals, but because she has been eating at a 1,200 calorie low-carb diet, I would highly suggest that she reverse out of that and gradually start adding in carbs every week, maybe like 50 grams of carbs every day for a week, and then the next week another 50 grams and so forth until she gets up. Because if she jumps right into her TDEE with moderately active, the scale is going to jump, and she's probably going to freak out. If she's already freaking out about eating more than 1,200 calories a day now, she's going to freak out if she does that. I think if she reverses out of the diet that she's in, and it may take, you know, a month and a half to do that, that she'll be in a much better place to do that. So, but I think that she should start with moderately active, and usually based off of her body fat percentage, and Mike will probably chime in, I always like to defer back to 1 gram per pound of body weight, because most of the time, if you don't do the 1 gram per pound, then that leaves you with more carbs, you know, or, you know, and more fat. And typically I've seen women, unless they did, you know, really awesome at a paleo style diet, a lot of women, once you start introducing those carbs in, you can't have those fats at a higher level, because the fats combined with the higher carbs is usually bad news.
It's just too many calories.
You can drop them fat.
What do you think, Mike?
No, I would definitely agree with that. I always like that, exactly what you said, that the numbers are an end goal about where you should get to at some point, not get there overnight. One, even if you could do that psychologically, you probably can't handle it because you're already nervous about adding some carbohydrates. So it's a little bit of too much of a jump for you to add a whole bunch of them. And I've just seen it happen time and time again. I know you guys have seen the same thing. You know, someone starts doing CrossFit, they start doing 3, 4, 5 workout of the days a week, you know, highly glycolytic exercise, right? Exercise primarily using carbohydrates. They feel good for 2 to 6 weeks, maybe about 4 weeks. They lose a fair amount of fat, they feel awesome. And then all of a sudden they're like, wait a minute, I'm not making any progress. Oh, I feel like dog food now. I don't know what happened. Well, what happened was that your body says, hey, I can't handle that much more stress anymore, right? It's very stressful to do that type of exercise without providing the fuel to do it. So just slowly increase carbohydrates, note how you feel, make sure you track your performance in your workouts. Don't just go by, well, I tried really hard and it was brutal. Okay, you know, maybe it was, but you want to see, are you making incremental progress over time, right? Are you building more and more capacity? So,
all right. We'll get there. I hope that answers your question, Michelle. We got, she says, yep, thanks. She's trying. Let's go back into that too. She's trying to drop body fat, and I would agree. You kind of have to get back to a baseline before you start. If you're already in a calorie deficit and you've been there for a long time, it's going to be kind of hard to coax the fat loss adaptation out of your body once you kind of run it dry. If you look at it like that, if that's a good way to look at it. So yeah, we usually recommend that people do that. They find a baseline, and then they decrease their calories, whether it's 10%. If you're working out, you're working out 3 or 4 times a week, then you can spend another 3 or 4 days out of the week in a calorie deficit, a very slight calorie deficit, and that'll add up over time. And you won't sacrifice performance. You won't sacrifice muscle mass, which is extremely important. So you get kind of the best of both worlds, but you got to gradually work back up to what would essentially be, if you're familiar with other terminology, I guess maintenance, right?
No, I would agree with that, because the reality is, if you're at 400 calories a day, it's like, where are you going to go, right? Are you going to drop down to 1,000 and then 800 calories a day? It's like, yeah, it may work for a very short period of time, but no one's going to want to eat 800 calories a day the rest of their life, and I don't think there's any reason you would need to do that, nor should you do that.
So, yeah, I would agree with that.
Send the circle in the other direction.
All right. If we have any other attendees with questions, go ahead and ask, whether it's obscure, whether it's very specific. Until then, does anyone want to talk about their training or their nutrition or their goals right now? April?
Well, I'm in a similar boat as you. I'm doing some videos, so I'm just instructing one of the models that's helping me. So I'm doing a full Strongman competition in spring. So it's funny, like, different sports have different weight cutoffs. So for strongmen, like, the lightweight cutoff is 231 pounds. But I do a lot of kiteboarding. So if you kiteboard and you're over 200 pounds, it's like, oh, if you're a big dude, you know. For strongmen, it's like, if you're 231 under, you're in, like, the lightweight division. So I find that kind of funny. So just doing that up until this next coming week. And then I have my first novice competition on January 25th, which, I don't know, you know, there's a couple of weights I know I can't do already, you know, but it's a good experience, you know, go show up, do the best you can, and then, you know, get better from there. So it's, I just got a strongman log for Christmas, so it's been really fun.
Yeah, I saw that in some of your videos.
Fun. So are you trying to gain weight to get to the higher category in the strongman?
Yeah, so my plan was initially, before I realized I had to do the video shoots, and nobody really cares about what I do for my own training per se when you're explaining stuff. So I got up to 240, and then I was going to stay there up until probably about 3 or 4 months before the event in spring. So I just had to drop down a little bit from there faster. So I don't know, so I probably dropped 8 pounds in probably about the last, like 8 weeks or so, somewhere around there. It's usually easier for me to drop down to a specific weight faster. After there, it gets a little bit harder. Usually I have this really weird thing where I can eat a lot and not really gain a lot of weight per se. But then when I start coming back down the other way, I see like a really fast drop, and then it's a little bit slower after that. So
yeah, I have a meet in April. And
oh, there you go, nice.
So I'm training for that right now, but I'm trying to get onto a program that allows me to kind of maintain progress and just build very, very slowly rather than peaking, because that's just extremely, extremely stressful. I had, hopefully everyone's familiar with him, I had Dan Green write me a program and do some online coaching with me for my first meet, and that worked out extremely well. Like, I added 50 or 60 pounds onto each lift, and I'm still kind of weak because I just started doing this stuff about 2 years ago. But right now I'm doing Brandon Lilly's cube method, and that's really nice because it has you go and do a heavy day 1 week.
Yep.
And then a light day the next week, and then a speed day the other week. So you work all three of the primary strength qualities. You got endurance, maximal strength, and speed, rate of force development, I guess, however you want to look at it. And it's really nice because you get to take a break. You can look forward to your heavy day. You look forward to your rep days. But, I mean, I did my repetition day today, and as I do this, I'm trying to cut weight. So I've gone from about 175 pounds waking up to about 165 pounds, and it's getting harder and harder and harder. But I think this style of training lends itself really well to a slow recomposition or a fat cut. And I want to compete in 165, which I right now I can do. But today I woke up at 166 pounds, and I would have to go and I'd have to do some water manipulation or something very, very, very mild to hit 165 so that I weighed in the next lowest weight class. Not the biggest deal for me since this is still the beginning of my powerlifting career as I see it. But I think things are going really well. April, what are you doing at the moment?
Oh, I'm still building. I'm over a year in. I was actually talking to a friend of mine earlier, and my short-term goals are I would really like to get my carbs up to 400 grams on my training days. Just to show everybody in the forum that you and still maintain and not get fat and don't be afraid of it. I usually hang out around 325, 330, something like that on my training days. On my rest days, I'm usually around 225, somewhere along those lines. But the company that he works for, they have the annual claims conference in, it's in July this year. And I usually will wear like a strapless dress and like a little short dress or something there to show all the other, make all the other women jealous and stuff. Well, I'm thinking I might have to do a mini cut before July. So I may do that maybe starting around maybe May, something like that. But it's kind of funny now because I've kept my carbs and my calories so high now that, you know, if I go one day with, you know, say, husband brings home a steak and, you know, I go over on protein and don't go as high on carbs or something like that, literally I can be down like 3-4 pounds the next day, you know, just easily like that. So it's going to be very interesting to see how I can cut on such a higher calorie standpoint than, you know, than years before. So it's going to be fun.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I mean, I'm losing about a quarter pound every week, which isn't a huge, it's not a very quick rate of fat loss, but I'm maintaining my strength or probably getting a little bit stronger, and I'm looking better every week. So I'm pretty happy with it. But I do notice the same thing. If I cut my carbs out and I keep them around 200, 250 on my rest days, and they're up into the 400s, almost 500 on training days sometimes, which isn't always deliberate. Sometimes I'm going lower fat, sometimes I'm going higher carb, but I'll lose 5 or 6 or 7 pounds overnight. So, I mean, I think that we talk about that. That's a sign that you have become metabolically flexible. You can use your carbs up. You can run through a lot of glycolytic activity and actually respond well to it rather than just feeling bloated and watery or however else you describe it.
Exactly. So,
I have another question from Eric Borst. He says, right now I eat about 350 grams of carbs on my heavy days and 200 to 250 on my control days. Protein is about 200 grams every day. That sounds extremely similar to what I do. All right. I'm around 13% body fat, and I want to start getting closer to 8 or 10 to increase my efficiencies with body weight movements. But I don't want to lose any performance or strength. How can I do this, or is losing 3% body fat not really worth the effort, and is there enough to gain? I weigh 195 pounds right now. Thanks. How tall are you, Eric, if you can type that in real quick? Until then, I'd say, I mean,
I think typically with men, when you start getting sub-10, it starts getting pretty damn hard.
Yeah,
you know, it's not easy, you know.
People digits are much lower than people realize. They see 10% and they go, that's high. I'm like, no, that's
exactly low. Exactly. Yeah, you start trying to get below 10, it's, you know, your performance is going to be, it's going to be affected from it. You know, I think you got to choose, you know, do you want to focus on that, or do you want to continue performing? You know, I'm sure with 13%, I'm sure he's got abs, you know.
Oh,
sure,
yeah.
You know.
That's all. I'm trying to get a handle on this, because if you're 13%, 195 pounds, I mean, I'm 5'6". If I were to be 195 pounds at 13% body fat, that would be like a miracle. So I'm trying to put it into perspective. But yeah, definitely.
That would be a dream come true, James.
If you want to prioritize body weight movements, you do want to be lighter. You do want to be leaner. But I'm not sure if I would suggest dropping below 10% body fat. I think the reward there is that you're going to look shredded. You're going to look really, really good if your body fat right now has actually been accurately tested, because you may be 13%, you may be 11%, you may be 15%. There's a margin of error. So, I mean, I guess my opinion is that you have to, like, you got to look at it from a performance perspective, because you're not exactly fat at this point. You're probably a really good looking guy, probably lean. You got to ask, like, is it worth it? It might be worth it to do a bodybuilding show if you wanted to drop to 8%. But as far as performance on your body weight movements, I don't exactly think so. And you would probably lose strength. I mean, it's very, very difficult for most people to gain strength, let alone maintain strength on a cut.
Now, he may can, since he's averaging around 200, 250 grams of carbs on his rest days, he may can try to gradually, you know, cut those down to like 175 and just gradually drop, you know, 1 or 2%. You know, it's going to take a little bit of time to do that with just that slight, you know, slight deficit. But I really wouldn't do anything more aggressive than that if his performance is going well and, you know, and everything's going great now.
Yeah, I think if you follow the standard model that we present, cycling calories between rest and work and training days, and Eric is 5'11", so I mean that's a good build for a guy that's almost 6 feet tall, 195 pounds.
Yeah.
He's almost 6 feet tall, and you're lean, so you're probably looking at wanting to actually put on some muscle if you can. I would prioritize a slow recomposition. And you can do that just by cycling your calories down, like April said. Just drop things a little bit on your rest days. I'm talking a little bit too much. Mike, what's your opinion on the subject?
What I would do is, if Eric was Michael on, I usually say, okay, so here's the path you can go on. I agree with everything you guys said. And at some point, you'll have to decide which one is a higher priority. So if you're getting leaner and your body weight stuff is getting better, then cool, right? No worries. You don't have to worry. If at some point you're getting leaner, but now your body weight stuff isn't improving as fast, now you're going to have to decide, okay, which one do I want to prioritize? Do I really want to get leaner, whatever that definition is for you, or do I want to get better at body weight exercises? Because they may not necessarily be as associated as what you think, right? So if you look at 2%, right, so 2% of 200 is 4 pounds, right? Unless you're doing a body weight drill where you added 4 pounds to your feet on a front lever or something, right? You know, massive amounts of leverage, it may not make all that much, you know, difference. So at some point you may have to decide what direction do I really want to go, and, you know, which one is a higher priority. And then I would have people pick a specific period of time just to work on that. So you may say, okay, I really want to get leaner. I don't want to get horrible body weight drills, so I'm going to take the next 4 to 8 weeks. See if I get a little bit leaner, if my body weight stays about the same for strength and stuff, I'm okay with that. And at the end of that, I'll reassess again and go, okay, so now I'm quite a bit leaner. Now I want to keep this level of leanness and increase my body weight drills a little more, whatever. So I usually have people try to, once they hit the road where they kind of have to decide, you know, pick a direction, go there for a period of time, and you can change after that period of time. But at some point, if you're, you know, trying to ride two horses with one ass or butt, sorry, I shouldn't swear, it's going to become a lot harder than at that point.
All right, well, I hope that answers your question, Eric. If it doesn't, feel free to elaborate. Feel free to ask another question. I'm going to move on to, he says, oh, awesome. He says it makes sense. Look shredded is not his goal. He wants to be able to crush his wads, so he thinks he's going to stick with where he's at. And I think that's a great idea, because I mean, just off the top of my head, I think I saw a video of Konstantin Konstantinovs. He's a Russian. He's extremely, extremely strong, and he's not too bad at his body weight movements. And as far as CrossFit goes, I mean, Jason Kalipa, he probably weighs in over 200 pounds at various points, and he's not exactly bad at doing his body weight movements. And I'm not sure what the stats are on the average weight for a male gymnast, but, I mean, I'm sure there are guys that are in the low 200s, mid 200s, maybe even. doing some ridiculous stuff with their bodies, doing planches. Not really big into gymnastics, but I mean, just to quickly to move on, Mike, is there really a way to correlate body weight with performance in terms of gymnastics or body weight movements like that?
Yeah, it's, you're looking at relative strength, right? So if you're looking at CrossFit, even if you watched a lot of the games for the men, I'd say most of men are very lean. Would I say they're extremely bodybuilder lean? No. But I think at some point, then that's going to impair your performance, right? So they're kind of at that sort of happy medium where they're definitely very lean, but their performance is still good. Most gymnasts, if you mean very, very high-level gymnasts in person, they're
Olympians.
You won't see many gymnasts that are much above 5'8", and that's tall for a gymnast. So if you're, you know, almost 6 feet, can you get better at bodyweight stuff? Sure. Are you going to ever reach probably an elite level of the stuff a lot of gymnastics people do? Probably not. But, you know, you can definitely get better from, you know, where you're at. And then he also mentioned that he wants to get better at his WADs. So that may be a separate, different performance thing. So they may do a lot of bodyweight stuff, you know, but they may do a lot of the more plastic barbell type stuff too. So again, goes back to, you know, what are your goals? How do you measure them? And what do you want to focus on?
Yeah, with CrossFit, you really don't know what you're getting into. It right. Could be you have to do a lot of bodyweight stuff, but. I mean, I've been following the games since before Eat to Perform started, before I had done any CrossFit, and I mean, they're really strong. Those guys are just they're 8 weeks out from being able to go and win a powerlifting meet. They're 8 weeks out from being able to go. I mean, a lot of them, they can beat the crap out of a 5K. They're very good runners. They're very balanced athletes. So you got to kind of look at it like if you're going to be ready for, do you want to be ready for anything or do you want to start to specialize in something, you know? So I think if you're going after something like those bar stars or bartenders guys that are doing the human flagpoles and stuff, might just want to stay where you are. All right, we have another question from Rachel. I cannot pronounce your last name, and I do not want to offend you by mispronouncing it. Yep. But Rachel asks, she says, I really enjoy dark chocolate. Does this fit in with ETP, and when would be the best time to consume it? April, what do you think?
I eat dark chocolate every single day.
Yay. Oh, yeah.
Every single day I eat dark chocolate, so yes, it would fit. You know, it pretty much would fit mostly anywhere. I usually have mine, I eat dinner, and then I actually eat a protein oatmeal that I melt dark chocolate in. It's a chocolate protein oatmeal that I eat. I usually have cereal before bed. But, you know, I think pretty much if you want to focus it around your workout, I'm assuming she's not eating a large quantity of it, because I usually only have less than 100 calories of it a day, but I do eat dark chocolate every day. So,
yeah, I would think that you can pretty much unless you're eating 2,000 calories worth of dark chocolate, I don't think it's going to make or break anything. And if you enjoy it, then there's a lot to be said about that. You're forcing yourself to avoid dark chocolate for that 100 calories or 200 calories even, then it's probably not worth it. You know, if you really love something, if it gets you through your day, you have to look at the psychology of this whole thing. If it gets you through your day to have some dark chocolate melted into your oatmeal, or just to have a piece before you go to bed, or even when you wake up in the morning, at any time of the day, it's probably worth it. What do you think, Mike?
No, I totally agree. The one thing, when I get stressed out, I eat a lot of chocolate. When I was finishing my PhD, chocolate bars would just, my wife would buy them, and they would just disappear. You know, and part of it I knew was a stress response, but at that point, yeah, my priority was more on finishing, and if I ate a bunch of chocolate, that wasn't going to be the end of the world either, you know. So for most people, I have them look at the percentage. Usually the higher percentage they can go, usually the better. So if they only like milk chocolate, even if they get a, you know, 60 or 70%, well, that's okay. And then over time, what I found is a higher percentage chocolate, obviously, is usually less calories, less carbohydrates, more vegetable, you know, polyphenols, all that kind of stuff. And usually what's interesting is that most people don't eat nearly as much of it either, which I found. I don't know if you guys have found the same thing, but if you take like an 86% or 90% cacao and chocolate, it's very satisfying. It's a little bit more bitter, and rarely will someone like finish a whole bar of it.
Yeah, it's kind of like an appetite.
Well, but it's
kind of like an appetite suppressant.
I do the 86-90%, and I usually like one square a day.
To me, it's like coffee. I mean, I just finished a cup of coffee, and I'm sitting here thinking, like, I have eaten chocolate-covered coffee beans, and I get the kind of the same effect. It's like it turns something off that makes me hungry, just like drinking a lot of water. So, I mean, I think under those circumstances, if it has that same effect for you, if you notice you can't really eat a lot of it anyways because it's bitter, it's not like milk chocolate where you might be able to just eat an entire bunny rabbit or something in a sitting, then it's probably very useful. I hope that answers your question. I'm going to end the broadcast in about 4 minutes, but I'm going to stay on. I don't know what April and Mike are doing, and if anyone's got any more questions, feel free to ask. We got another 4 minutes. Yeah. Don't be shy. I'm going to switch from my coffee cup to this giant jug of water, which is almost empty. So unless anyone's got a question, do you have any New Year's resolutions, guys?
I don't believe in resolutions. I just believe in setting goals. Resolutions are they're too stereotypical. Just basically set goals and reach them, you know, because resolutions, typically people tend to break them. They say, you know, I'm going to do this or, you know, do that. And if you have to wait till the new year to make a goal or to make a resolution to do something, then chances are you weren't strong enough to do it to begin with. So, you know, that's just my thoughts.
Yeah, I tend to agree. I think if it helps people and it's an ideal time frame for them to do something to make progress, awesome. I've even gotten so far as what you were saying is I used to be very goal-orientated, and now I'm actually even more, I don't want to say less goal-orientated, but more intention-orientated, because I think that it's a little bit of a change of words. I get this from Brian Grasso, that intention, I think, is a little bit more all-encompassing and tells you the direction to go in, and is a little bit less specific.
Mm-hmm.
So it's less, because there's some people who do really good with goal setting, but then they feel completely horrible if they didn't make their goal, right? They're kind of this all or nothing personality. So I found if you just, you know, give them sort of a direction, and yeah, you want to know what is good, and you want to have markers along the way if you're progressing or not progressing. I don't know, that's kind of where I've been leaning a little bit more now. It's very similar in idea, but for some personalities, I find that intention is just a little bit better. And then I'm really big on how would they measure it, right? Because once you achieve whatever it is you wanted to achieve, it's okay to give yourself the little victory and cross it off and be excited that you actually made it, whether you're doing a meet or you're doing a competition or whatever it is. I think that's a very good thing of having sort of concrete things to know that you've actually made it.
That's kind of how I feel. I mean, I keep saying that after this powerlifting meet, I'm going to do a weightlifting meet for the end of the year. But, I mean, that's just my intention. It's not necessarily a goal. I'm going to start snatching and cleaning and jerking next week, doing it on a very regular basis while I train for my meet. I'm going to keep that up because I want to do it. But will I actually enter a weightlifting meet at the end of the year? Will I stop doing powerlifting until 2015? I don't know, because it's going to depend upon 1,000 other factors, but it is my intention. I think that's a great way to put it. That's my intention to become a more balanced strength athlete. I mean, I want to do a strongman competition at the end of the year if I can. I just have to find something to do. Yeah, I mean, and I feel like I'm better at loading stones. It took me 2 sessions to get a 185-pound stone from the floor to my shoulder. And
nice.
That's my body weight, essentially.
That's good.
Yeah. So I would love to do something like that. I have another question from Michelle, and then I think we're going to wrap things up. She asks, is it okay to drink beer or alcohol while doing ETP? I'm not a heavy drinker, but I do like my Michelob Ultra every now and then. Do we just account for that in our daily counts? I'm going to defer to Mike since he's on the screen right now.
Well, first you have to only drink dark beer and then it's okay. No. To be perfectly honest, I don't actually get that bent out of shape about it, to be perfectly honest. I know people that have beer on occasion. I like drinking dark beer on occasion. Again, it's like anything else. Is drinking a beer going to get you closer to your goals? Yeah, not necessarily. Is it going to horribly detract you off into no man's ville? No. It's kind of more neutral. I mean, as long as it's some type of moderation. You know, if you're going out and having, you know, six beers on a weekend, no, that's not good. I mean, you've got all the food that you eat with it, and you're not training, you're not sleeping, and all that kind of stuff. If you're having a beer with dinner once in a while or a glass of wine, I don't really worry that much about it, to be honest. Rarely have I ever seen in someone's program that was the thing that was the make or break one.
Yeah,
what do you guys say?
I'm kind of in the same vein. I'm coming out of, you know, New Year's. I went and drank too many beers. I came home. I didn't feel bad. I was just a little drunk. No harm done. I had a chicken salad. I was toasty. Yes. I had a chicken salad with a lot of dressing on it, and I couldn't sleep because I felt sick. So, I mean, you got to look at it like that. Is it going to impede your fat loss? Is it going to impede your performance? Depends on where you push it to. If you're drinking, you're not a heavy drinker, you say, then I don't see why it would be a problem as long as you account for it in your total daily energy expenditure. I mean, some strategies that you can use to get past that are to eat most of your food in the beginning of the day. And then if you're going to go out and you're going to do what I guess would qualify as binge drinking, although it depends on how much you're drinking, you're going to go and have three or four or five or maybe even six beers, or you're going to have some drinks, just eat most of your food in the beginning of the day. Eat a lot of protein. Eat most of your fat then, because I know this, and Mike can elaborate on it if he cares to, that alcohol consumption kind of screws with fat metabolism. Is that right?
I've seen stuff that goes both ways on that. So the standard theory is that because alcohol is, in essence, sort of a poison, that your body will put on hold fat metabolism in order to detoxify it first. I don't know, to be honest. I mean, I'd have to go back and look again. I mean, that's sort of what's always been postulated, but I kind of have my doubts if that's what really happens. I think the bigger thing is, by far, the other things that are associated with it. So not only is it the empty calories, not only is it the alcohol, not only is it the amount. Most people don't make the world's best, you know, food choices in, right? You ever got out drinking with your buddies? Do they ever be like, oh, yeah, lean chicken breast, I want three of those, right?
Yeah.
It just doesn't happen. Normally, you don't sleep real well, all that kind of stuff. So I think there's the alcohol itself, and then there's all the other behaviors that are normally associated with it, too.
So it's more like a lifestyle factor than anything.
Not necessarily. I mean, rarely do I know people that go out routinely and get up at 7 a.m. to train the next day. You know, if that's part of their lifestyle, going out Friday and Saturday night all the time, rarely are they getting up and training the next day. Mm-hmm. You know, if you have one once in a while and you go out, I don't think it's that big of a deal if it's an occasional type thing.
So. I agree with that completely.
What do you say, April?
Well, I'm not a big alcohol drinker. I drink maybe once every 6 months, maybe if that, once or twice a year, but I'm not a big alcohol drinker. I do agree with what Michael's saying in regards to, I do think alcohol is a poison to your body, and basically all processes will stop until it's processed out of the body. Typically for me, whenever I do drink alcohol, like I said, a couple times a year, I only drink vodka. I'll drink Grey Goose vodka, and, you know, I typically will do protein. I'll do low-fat protein, you know, lower carbs around the times that I'm consuming it. And, you know, I'll typically use, like, mixers that are, you know, mix it with, like, water or, you know, something like that. So that's just me. I'm just neurotic about that stuff, though.
I'm
not a beer drinker, and I do not like the taste of beer. But now, if I was a beer drinker and I actually enjoyed the taste of beer, I would I would say that if you're actually drinking to, if you enjoy the taste, then go with a darker beer. If you're actually going to get the, to feel the effects of the alcohol, like to get a buzz, then I would suggest not drinking the Michelob Ultra because the alcohol content is so low on it, you're actually better off in drinking one dark beer versus three of the Michelob Ultra. You know, you would actually have to consume more of those to equal, you know, the same effects of one or two of the dark beers. So.
Yeah, and stay away from Bud Light and stuff like that. Go for something enjoyable. If you are gonna use, if you're gonna drink alcohol, make sure that it's worth it. I mean, I'll call it Yingling. Why not? I usually go with some Yingling or some Amber Bock or something like that. But unless it's beer pong, I don't know if you guys play beer pong or anything. I'm still in that
Nobody
stage of my life.
That.
I'll admit to it. I played beer pong a couple weekends ago, and I lost. But you know. It just depends on the context within your life and within the situation. If anyone's got any questions, I think I'm going to wrap it up. We'll just do one more question, if that's all right with you guys.
I will say, if you stay up till 3 in the morning at a conference and do shots of tequila, your heart rate variability score the next morning will be just horrible. Not that I know that. But.
Not that you know that. Hey, we should take this time.
About deep research then, though, so it was okay.
We should take this time to mention to anyone listening that all the questions that we're answering, the kind of support that we're offering you, this is available to you every day in our Science Lab forum. April's in there, I'm in there, and we're answering questions. We're helping everyone get their TDEE calculations set up, modifying it, giving training suggestions, everything. And while this is excellent, you know, we don't do these every day. So if you have any further questions, that's the best place to reach us. And we've got several other moderators that, I mean, they're people that are intelligent, they're informed on all these subjects. They're not Mike T. Nelson, but they're all right. And I think if there are no further questions, we're going to wrap things up. I'd like to thank everyone for coming. I'd like to thank Mike for being here. This is all kind of last minute.
Thank you very much.
We'll do another one at some point, I'm sure. April, thank you.
It was fun.
Yeah, I agree. All right. Have a good night, everybody.
Good night.
You're welcome.
See you guys. Thank you. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.